Sunday after Easter or in Eastertide. This morning we're going to be doing an instructive Eucharist, so the sermon will be quite short, but scattered through the service will be at pivot points. There will be brief explanations about what we're going, what we're doing, what we're about to do, why we're doing it. And in all of this, I keep hearing my mother saying to me, "Harrison, we don't need to know everything, you know. You don't have to tell us everything, you know." That's Harrison. You don't have to tell us everything, you know. So my mother is saying that to me, and I will do my best to keep it brief. So, to begin, what are we up to? We're up to liturgy, which is the work of the people. That's what the word means. And so we're doing the work of the people, which is to set forth God's praise for ourselves, for the benefit of our community, for the benefit of the church, and for the benefit of the whole world. So it's not just for us that we're doing this. We're doing this for the whole world. So that's why we do some of the things that we're doing. And our liturgy on Sunday mornings, the principal act of worship, according to the prayer book, is the Holy Eucharist. The holy, something that's sacred, that's set apart for God. And it's a Eucharist. It is a good gift, which gets translated Thanksgiving. So it is the thing that we do on this day, especially to offer our profound thanks to God for all that God has done for us. Our service begins, well, before it begins, there's quiet. And you may think, not when I've been in church. And that's an issue for us, friends. There are people who like to come into church for a moment of quiet prayer. And perhaps when we get back together to in-person worship, we can do that. We can exercise a bit of silence before the postman begins. And yes, I know we're glad to see everybody. And boy, when we get back together again, whenever that's going to be, more about that later, we're going to be really glad to see each other. So it's going to be really hard to have a moment of quiet. And then comes the prelude, which is a bit of delight, and also a way for us to center down and to open our hearts as a way, you know, music can reach us the way nothing else can. And so it's a way for us to center down and get focused and let our hearts be opened to God. And then there are two big main parts of the service that follows. There's the liturgy of the table, otherwise known as the Word of God. The liturgy of the Word, that's the first part. The liturgy of the Word, otherwise known as the Word of God. And the second part is the liturgy of the table, or the Great Thanksgiving, or the Holy Communion. So we're now in the beginning of the liturgy of the table, of the Word. We're at the beginning of the liturgy of the Word, and in the part that's liturgists call the opening rite. Now, just because I can't resist, I have to tell you about the difference between a liturgist, someone who studies liturgy, and a terrorist. Do you know about this, the difference between a liturgist and a terrorist? The difference is you can negotiate with a terrorist. So we are here. We are in the opening rite, and it begins with the way we're doing it now. Usually, when we were all here together, we'd have a hymn, actually is an entrance. So we begin with the opening acclamation, and then we have our opening hymn. So because it's Easter time, our opening acclamation comes right out of the stories of the resurrection of Jesus. And it will be followed then by a hymn that's appropriate for Easter time. So, and one of you asked about how do we choose the hymns and the length of the hymns? Well, we choose the hymns based on their appropriateness for the readings of the day. Mark sends me some suggestions. We consult various sources, and we have a little back and forth sometimes, and sometimes I say, absolutely, exactly what was on my mind. And then we decide on how many verses we're going to sing. My rule of thumb is that we sing typically no more than 16 bars of a hymn, and unless it's something, you know, we really just need to sing all of it, or it moves along really well. Sometimes we leave out verses because they're not appropriate to that particular Sunday. We've been, since we've begun this live stream worship, we've been tending to have shorter hymn sings than when we were all here together. You need to know that your rector loves to sing hymns. So that's why we tend to sing more than less. And so, I think we're ready to begin now. So, we begin with that Easter acclamation. Alleluia! Christ is risen!
The Lord is risen indeed!
Alleluia! And our opening hymn is number 405. You're following in the hymnal, and it's printed out here in your online bulletin.
Thank you.
part of the opening rite, which is what is known as the College for Purity. It's not labeled as such, but that's the nickname that this prayer has. It's a very old prayer. It comes from the medieval rite of Sarum. That's the medieval Latin name for Salisbury. And it was given its current form by Archbishop Thomas Cranmer as part of the English Reformation. And you'll notice there's a rubric. The rubric says, the celebrant may say. That means that I don't have to, but I might, that I may, and so I will. Let us pray. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated if you're standing. Just a few things about the readings. We have four readings. We have the first reading, which is typically from the Hebrew Scriptures, except during Easter time when it's from the Acts of the Apostles. And then we have a psalm, which somehow is tied into or celebrates what's happening into, it's kind of a sung response, except that we will be saying it, to the first reading. And then there's an epistle, and then there's the gospel. And some of you may wonder, why do we have all these readings? I remember when we just had the epistle and the gospel. Well, friends, that was from the days when you were expected to have first gone to morning prayer and heard the Old Testament reading at morning prayer and said the psalm of the day at morning prayer. And then you came back, you know, later in the day for the Holy Eucharist. That was the pattern that was in the mindset of those who arranged the pattern of readings in the 1928 prayer book then and earlier. So that, of course, is long fallen out of use. And so now we have all four readings, as was done in the time of the early church. Our readings come from the Revised Common Lectionary, a three-year cycle of readings that is shared among the mainline English-speaking churches. It was also in the setting up of the Revised Common Lectionary. There were Roman Catholic liturgical scholars who were involved in that. And although the Roman Catholic lectionary is very much like the Revised Common Lectionary, it varies a little bit in places. And that's because it's for not just the English-speaking world, but for the entire Roman Catholic Church around the world. And so we'll have those readings and coming from this three-year cycle, the epistle follows a sequence sort of its own, and then the gospel reading, which is the principal reading of the day, is the reading that, now in Eastertide, it's telling stories and relating passages from the gospel according to John about and from, that we can just imagine the risen Christ sharing with his people, with his first followers. Then, the rest of the year, there are things that are tied to the seasons getting ready for Christmas, that season of Advent, which is when the Christian year begins, and then readings tied, gospel readings tied to the Epiphany and the story of the manifestation of Jesus in the world as the Son of God. So the sequence of readings during the season after the Epiphany. In Lent, we're dealing with sin and what separates us from the love of God, and then we're back to Eastertide. In these 3 years, the readings are typically taken from, in year A, Matthew, except during the season after after Easter. when we come to the season after Pentecost, then we're just going to be reading the teachings from the Gospel according to Matthew in course. And in year B, those readings are from the Gospel according to Mark, and in year C, from the Gospel according to Luke. Before we get into that, however, there's the hymn of praise that we're going to say. Often we sing it, and it varies from what's appropriate to the season of the year. And the Pascha Nostrum, or Alleluia, Christ our Passover, is actually an Anglican creation. Remember, Archbishop Thomas Cranmer, he took these verses from Paul's letters to the Corinthians and to the Romans and put them together to create this hymn of praise. So I invite you here to stand, or stand up in your hearts, joining us from home as we offer this hymn of praise together. Alleluia! Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. Therefore let us keep the feast, not with the old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Alleluia! Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death that he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So also consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Alleluia. Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. Alleluia. Before the readings, there's the collect of the day, the prayer that collects, the prayers that maybe you've been offering as you came in to worship, as you were preparing for worship, and as we look ahead to the readings. It's sort of the theme prayer of the day. It's usually especially tied, has a connection to the gospel reading of the day. So the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Saying together, O God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love towards you, that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Though indeed, he is not far from each of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. And as even some of those of your own poets have said, for we are to his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, or an image formed by the art or imagination of mortals. While God has overlooked the times of human ignorance, now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will have the world judged in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us say together responsibly my verse, portions of Psalm 66. Bless our God, you peoples, make the voice of his praise to be heard.
Who holds our souls in life and will not allow our feet to slip.
For you, O God, I have proved us. You have tried us just as silver is tried.
You brought us into the snare. You laid heavy burdens upon our backs.
You let enemies ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us out into a place of refreshment.
I will enter your house with burnt offerings, and will pay you my vows, which I promised with my lips and spoke with my mouth when I was in trouble.
I will offer you sacrifices of fat beasts with the smoke of rams. I will give you oxen and goats.
Come and listen, all you who fear God. I will tell you that what he has done for me.
I called out to him with my mouth, and his praise was on my tongue.
If I had found evil in my heart, the Lord would not have heard me.
But in truth, God has heard me, and he has attended to the voice of my prayer.
Blessed be God, who has not rejected my prayer, nor withheld his love from me.
Yet who is the gentlest
The Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and the Father will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you, and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father. And I will love them and reveal myself to them." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. So our Lord's commandment is that we are to love one another as he has loved us. We're to love one another, we're to love God as God has been revealed through the person of Jesus. That's how we're to love one another. Dying to self. And so, that loving spirit just doesn't really coincide with what sometimes happens in the life of the church, where we sniff at those whose piety, whose way of worship, whose form of worship is different from our own. You know, there's something that they do that we don't do, and we think, what's up with that? As if there's something wrong. Or maybe they do something that we wouldn't think of doing. And we wonder, well, what's up with that? And maybe we just don't know. And instead of asking, why are you doing that? What does that mean to you? We think that there's something wrong with that. Friends, that is not the love of God. Now, yes, worship matters. And what we do in worship matters. And we're called to support one another in our worship. When we are together, in a corporate body, as the body of Christ gathered in one space, we are called to represent, to represent to the world the love of God incarnate. So that's going to be reflected in how we support one another in our worship together. And so let me just say a few things about posture and manual acts during worship. One of the manual acts that I don't think we see very much here at Christ Church, but you might see at other places, is that whenever people enter or leave their pew, they go down on one knee in the direction of the tabernacle to honor the presence of Jesus here in this space. It is in all things that are not central to worship. This is something that it's a good thing for some people to do. They really do need to do it, and they should. So, some should, no one must, and all may. Those, for the things that are adiaphora, for things that are not the essential acts of worship, all may, some should, no one must. And so, genuflecting as an act of reverence to the presence of our Lord in the tabernacle, that's one. Another is, you'll see people making the sign of the cross at various places. At the beginning of the service, at whenever there's a reference to baptism, when there's a reference to the Holy Spirit coming down, a reference to death, you'll see people making a sign of the cross. You may also, at the reading of the gospel, see people making three signs of the cross for purity of mind and lips, speech and expression, and of heart. Or another way to read that is, God be in my mind and on my lips and in my understanding. Biblical way of understanding is understand its heart. So, and you'll see me do that in the book, in the gospel. I'll make those three signs of the cross, and that's what I'm meaning when I do that. You'll see some people standing during the prayers of the Great Thanksgiving or the prayers of the people, and you'll see other people kneeling. Both instructions are given in the prayer. Both are perfectly acceptable postures for prayer, standing or kneeling. Kneeling is the posture that the prayer book recommends for confession. So there's, let's cut each other a little slack about posture. And how we stand. Then another thing, there's more about posture that I'll come to at the end, but right now, how about if I move on to talking about the creed? Some of you may remember when we said the Nicene Creed in an I form, a single form, person form. It wasn't the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed is the creed that we say in the daily office, and that is that we affirm at baptism, and that's the baptismal symbol. That's actually was its first name. The Apostles' Creed is the earliest expression of the faith of the whole church. The Nicene Creed was developed in the Council of Bishops from what was then the known world in Constantinople in 325. In Nicaea in 325, and confirmed in the Second Council in Constantinople in 381. They tweaked a few words. So, trying to come to terms with who Jesus was and who the Holy Spirit was, and how the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit are related to one another. And so, issues of the from the days of the early church finally got sorted in the Nicene Creed. And then in the Middle Ages, when the Nicene Creed, instead of being in a language of the people that everyone could say together, was said only the priest usually would be able to know the Latin form of the prayer. And so it went from, he said, why am I saying we? It's just me saying this. And so it went from me to I. And then in the renewal, liturgical renewal in the 20th century, we shifted back to this we form of the Nicene Creed. And this text that we use is one that's held in common by what's called the International Consultation on English Texts. There won't be a quiz, you don't have to remember that. But it's a consultation to settle the language that we were going to share together on important texts. And so that's the text that we have here. So I invite you to stand with me, or stand in your heart if you're at home, as we recall together what our hearts rest. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were. We acknowledge your baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. Now, there were a couple of manual acts that I did there that you advise about in his head. Well, it's in the name of Jesus, as Paul suggested we might do. And again, and at the incarnation, that was when Jesus, the Son of God, came and took on human flesh. Some folks do a more or less profound vow in honor of the incarnation and then the sign of the cross as an expression of solidarity with the baptismal faith of the church. Now we're going to move on to the prayers of the people. There have been prayers of the people from the earliest days of the church. They've taken various forms. And in the 1979 prayer, this is one of the places that the authors of the prayer book feel like, the revivers of the prayer book feel like what they were trying to do was not received in the spirit in which it was given. On the first page, on page 383 of the prayers, there are seven topics that are to be addressed in the prayers of the people. And then there are the forms that follow, showing how those forms could be addressed in a variety of ways. The expectation was that Sunday by Sunday and season by season, the church congregations, the gathered assemblies of God's people, would adapt these forms to address those seven topics in the prayers of the people. Instead, they kind of become, well, either we're going to do this one, this one, or this one, and we kind of stick closely to them. But if you notice, here at Christ Church, we follow, we change the form according to what seems to fit the season of the year. And now we're using form three, but it is revised to express the things that are on the hearts of the people, things that are going on in the world around us, and our patterns and traditions of prayer here at Christ Church. And so we'll have the prayers of the people.
Please join with us in this morning's prayers of the people.
Marcia.
You want me up there? I'm okay. Yeah. We will follow Form 3 as provided in your online bulletin and in the prayer book on page 387. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Remembering especially the clergy and people of the New Haven parishes of St. James, St. John's and St. Luke's, and the Anglican Church of Korea. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for our presiding Bishop Michael, our bishops Ian and Laura, our rector Harrison, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for your Holy Spirit to inspire with wisdom, decision-making, to promote the health and well-being of all peoples, as we pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
We pray for those commended to the prayers of the parish, including all affected by the current pandemic, the homeless and the lonely, for those suffering from addictions, victims of violence, for those serving in the military and their families, for the unemployed and the underemployed, and for those who are sick and suffering. Have compassion on them and on all those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
that they may be delivered from their distress.
Remembering all those who have died from the coronavirus and Ahmaud Arbery, give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
Remembering Ted Mumaw, Harriet Mack Mumaw, Philip and Marie Mack, whom we hold in blessed memory, we praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, including all those commended to the prayers of the parish, Julie Harris and Pam McGuigan, both recovering from orthopedic surgeries at home, Gabriel and Robin at home, Lisa and Matthew at home, Dale and Michelle at home, Lois Creighton and her recovery, Joan Gilliland with her daughter, for Ann and Dick as they adjust to being home in Guilford, for Annie and Jim who cannot be together, for all who face financial hardship because of the pandemic, and for those we name aloud or in silence, here or at home.
Lord Jesus Christ, who sent your apostles, peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever.
Amen.
And that prayer, friends, came from page 395 in the prayer book. It's not secret knowledge. The prayers that are used as the concluding collects for the prayers of the people often come from pages 394 and 395. And then we have, during most of the year, we have a prayer of confession. And so based on everything that's done and been said, it may be that we're feeling like, there are things that are on my heart that make me a little uneasy. And so we have the prayer of confession to set us in the right relationship with one another and with God, so we get to, in a corporate way, name those things, not the individual things, but generally, the things that we have done and the things that we have left undone. That's a very Anglican way to do this. The things that we've done and left undone that separate us from the love of God and from one another. The prayer book allows us to omit the prayer of confession upon occasion. And I once worked with as my rector, a fellow who, as one of his other associates would say, Duane took the prayer book at its word and upon occasion omitted the confession from Easter Sunday until the following Ash Wednesday. And so we don't quite do that here, at least during my tenure, but during the seasons of celebration and when there are baptisms, and of course we don't actually say the confession at weddings either, although that might be a good idea. We could maybe do well to do that. We only omit the prayer of confession during Christmas time, the season after the Epiphany, and Easter time, all the way through Pentecost Sunday. The Sunday, first Sunday after Pentecost, Trinity Sunday, look for it. The confession will either be back that Sunday or the Sunday thereafter. We'll see how it goes. But for now, because it's Easter, and we're in a celebratory mood, and we're grateful for what God has done to us in establishing new life for all of us and reconciling us, not because of anything we've done or said, but because of what Jesus has done for us, we feel free to share the peace of the Lord. So, my friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
And let's share that, and we'll do that at a distance.
Please be seated. Just a few announcements here. As this is one of the places where announcements suggested they be offered. Thank you to those of you who sent in questions, issues, concerns, thoughts about the Eucharist and our Sunday worship. And I hope that everything that you asked got a response that was helpful, and if not, you know how to reach me. After this service, we will have the virtual coffee hour, and that the link for that, it's a Zoom gathering, was in the letter that went out yesterday, and so follow that, or you can send a message to me, harrisonccc@snap.net, and I'll let you in. That will start at 11:30, as close to 11:30 as we can make that happen. I hope you've taken advantage of the Digital Sunday School. There's a lot more there about our readings for today than what I've addressed. Kyle did a really great job, fun things, things to color. I encourage you, and great questions for us to think about. I encourage you, if you haven't already, to look at the Digital Sunday School. It went out Friday afternoon at 1:37 in the afternoon. Memory serves. Thanks to everyone who participated in Mulch Weekend. Where you worked in the front and around the side of the church here, it just looks lovely. But it looks, like it's an outward visible sign that this is a place that people care about, and so it's just great. And those of you who were here yesterday were just so enthusiastic in your mulching that another shipment of mulch is going to arrive immediately after the service. Bless her heart, our junior warden, Alicia Bacon, is going to be doing that. Thanks to Alicia for that and all her organizing with Donald the Father, with the sign-up genius to get this mulch weekend together. Call your attention to that Friday letter for news about our outreach activities, and just want to celebrate what the mask crew has done. Last week they made 80 masks that were sent to the Navajo land, and God bless them for doing that. And in the coming week, they're providing 2 days of meals for the homeless who are served by the Amistad Catholic Workers House in New Haven. So God bless them. So if you made a special outreach gift, that's going to that. I hope you've looked at the documentary about serving undocumented immigrants, and the work that our parishioner Glenn Fulbright does. It's enough to break your heart, friends. If it doesn't break your heart, there's something wrong. I'm just going to tell you that. And I'm also going to tell you, and I quote scripture here, this is something that should give us all pause. This is the reason we all need to say the confession. Because there are sins being done for us. There are sins that are being done on our account, by our country, for which there is absolutely no writ in Holy Scripture, and for which we stand liable under the judgment of God. Yeah. Moving on. In the Friday letter about, or Saturday letter was this week, about reopening and the way that you can connect to the information that the vestry will be using as we talk about how we might return eventually.
not after May 20th, but maybe after June 20th, how we might return to corporate worship. And then invitation again this week about participating in the Sunday intercessions, Wednesday evening prayer, which will have a creation theme this week, because Wednesday is, it's a Rotation Day. It's the church's Earth Day from long before the secular world had an Earth Day. And then also an invitation to participate in Thursday morning Bible study. So I commend all that to you. And so at the end of these announcements comes the offertory, which is, I'll say an offertory sentence, and then there will be the table will be set, and I'll be putting on the chasuble, which is over there. And this is something that I do. Not everyone puts it on at this point, but I do, because I don't want to sit on it. And it's also a way to define the two, and respect the two parts of the Eucharistic service. There's the liturgy of the word, and there's the liturgy of the table. And so I put the chasuble on for the liturgy of the table. It's a poncho. It's an outer garment from the days of the early church. We hang on to everything. Just as this stole was a sign that, I'm a Roman citizen, that I'm a citizen of the church. At one point, that all meant the same thing. And I'm wearing standard street garb. That's what an olive is. It's just standard street garb from the days of the early church with a rope as a belt. All this stuff is just really old, and the church hangs on to it. As we set the table, there's going to be, except because we don't want to distract, I'm not going to do stuff while we're moving our hearts from the liturgy of the table to the liturgy, to the liturgy of the table from the liturgy of the word. So we're going to, the beneficiaries of a solo by thank you so much. And looking forward to this, indeed. And I have forgotten there is one thing that I usually do during the announcements, and that is conclude the offer just before we move into the offertory, and that is a birthday. And so you have your prayer book at home. You look at the back of the hymnal on page 830. There are actually two birthday prayers, and number 51 is the one we typically offer. And today we're celebrating Tuesday Hope Sarah's 90th birthday. So Hope's going to be 90 on Tuesday. God bless her. So grateful we get to offer this prayer for her. Watch over thy child, O Lord, as her days increase. Bless and guide Hope wherever she may be. Strengthen her when she stands. Comfort her when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise her up if she should fall, and in her heart may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of her life. And this we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Dear hearts, we've been richly blessed in the life of the kingdom. Let us with gladness present the alms and oblations of our life and labor.
Thank you. Thank you.
thin the line because it was so concentrated. And then after the table is set, there's what's called a lavabo, the washing of the hands. Well, we're doing it a little differently now in this season. We're using sanitary wipes or hand cleaner for this part of the service. Be sure that we're keeping things nice and clean. We are offering the bread and the wine, and we're also offering your gifts. So, Marcia, if you'd like to bring the offering forward, these are the gifts that you have sent in the days of yore. Those might have been bread and wine, or some other foodstuffs that were brought in, and that then were those ones that represent your life and work. And out of that bread will be taken the bread and the wine that will be used for the service, and the rest would go to sustain the poor. And there's a hymn that we sing during the offertory, the doxology, and so it's a hymn of praise and thanksgiving. Prayer from a book called Enriching Our Worship, which is particularly we are continuing to celebrate the Eucharist, even though none of us are going to actually receive the bread and the wine, because we want to have Jesus here with us now in the midst of our current trials. And so we're doing that for ourselves and for the larger community and for the whole world, and then the service ends with the doxology. During the course of that, you'll hear the tower bells ring. They ring at the high points of the Eucharistic rite for the bread, and the bread with the cup and the bread are instituted as Jesus' body and blood. And then there'll be an invitation to a spiritual communion. It'll be kind of like it was for those first followers of Jesus at Emmaus. We'll recognize Jesus in our midst, and then we'll meet before, you know, did you notice it doesn't say anything in that story about them actually? Jesus broke the bread, and Jesus disappeared, bodily disappeared, and Cleopas and his companion fled back to Jerusalem to tell the story. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to do that, and then we're just going to leave the bread and wine with the boy, and for another day, but we're not going to receive them. Instead, we'll offer a prayer of spiritual communion. So, with all that in our hearts and minds, we will pray together. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All thanks and praise are yours at all times and in all places, our true and loving God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, your eternal word, the wisdom from on high by whom you created all things, you laid the foundation of the world and enclosed the sea when it burst out from the womb. You brought forth all creatures of the earth and gave breath to humankind. Wondrous are you, Holy One of Blessing. All you create is a sign of hope for our journey. And so as the morning star sing your praises, we join the heavenly beings in all creation as we shout with joy,
Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God our might. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Glory and honor are yours, Creator of all. Your word has never been silent. You call the people to yourself as a light to the nations. You delivered them from bondage and led them to a land of promise. Of your grace you gave Jesus to be human, to share our life, to proclaim the coming of your holy reign and give yourself for us a sacred offering. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer, you have freed us from sin, brought us into your life, reconciled us to you, and restored us to the glory you intend for us. We thank you that on the night before he died for us, Jesus took bread. And when he gave the thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, his friends, and said, Take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, said the blessing, gave it to his friends, and said, Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. And so, remembering all that was done for us, the cross, the tomb, the resurrection, and ascension, longing for Christ's coming in glory and presenting to you these gifts your earth has formed and human hands have made, we acclaim you, O Christ.
Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Christ Jesus, come in glory.
Send your Holy Spirit upon us. the gifts of God for the people of God. I invite you to join with me in the prayer of spiritual communion. Lord Jesus, I cannot now worship you at the altar of the church in the sacrament of your body and blood. Yet in spirit, I will join myself with all those who in your holy church offer you the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Visit me, I pray, with your mercy, pardon, and blessing, and fill me with faith and love and repentance, and so strengthen and sustain me by your grace, that I may, with pure heart and mind, follow you, the only God, now and forever. consultation on English text that is shared among English-speaking liturgical Christians. We said that text because in the verse that in traditional form is and lead us not into temptation. That is a verse that is in dispute. Even Pope Francis is waiting on that and said that the usual translation just doesn't quite cut it and it is not helpful. And so the way that the and there's I wrote about that, this in a Friday message some weeks ago, that it's about the word temptation, test, and trial. The same word can be understood in all those ways. And the folks who prepared the ISA text thought that what made the most sense in the context was to render it as trial. So save us from the time of trial, and well, friends, we're in the time of trial. And so we're praying for God to save us in this time of trial and deliver us from evil when the evil is just so apparent to all of us. So when is the service over? The service actually, early Christian worship was hopped over just after the receiving of wine. And then, because it's the church's habit to build porches on porches, then there was added a prayer of thanksgiving, and then in some places there was added the saying of the glory, and then in some places was added reading a passage from the Gospel according to John, and then a dismissal eventually. So in the revisions that led to the our prayer book, most of those porches were removed, and we went back to one of the earliest 4th century forms, and to offer a post-communion prayer of thanksgiving, and then a blessing that came along later, and then a dismissal, which is the source of one of the names of the service, the Mass. In Latin, you say, Ecce Missa Est, and congregation eventually came to say, thanks be to God. You know, the service is not over. What the word actually means is, go, you are dismissed. And if you haven't seen Presiding Bishop Michael Curry's sermons where he talks about go, I encourage you to go on YouTube. It's like one of his favorite things to talk about. And so there's that. We sort of have another porch. It's very common in Anglican worship to observe another porch. After the dismissal, after we've said, okay, all we go, we have another porch. And that is, we do a little bit of fire worship. And we stay seated or on our knees while the candles are extinguished. Candles, friends, in Anglican worship are a fairly recent innovation. In fact, my previous parish in Chevy Chase, Maryland, split over the issue of whether there could be candles on the altar in the early 20th century. I'm not making this up. The rector wanted to have candles on the altar. They didn't have candles on the altar before. He wanted to have candles on the altar, and there was such a hue and cry that he left to start the church that is now on Chevy Chase Circle to go down right when you enter D.C. on Connecticut Avenue. There's a big circle of All Saints. Chevy Chase is there, and St. John's Norwood is just over on Wisconsin Avenue. And there are other sites of the Chevy Chase Country Club, which tells you more than you need to know. Just to say that St. John's Norwood is on the backside of the Chevy Chase Country Club. So there's that. And this is one of those places where, you know, friends, it's very popular. People leave right when they've been dismissed. It really is okay. But if you want to stay,
Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, grant you grace in every good work to do his will, perfecting in you that which is well pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
And so, dear hearts, wherever you are, let us bless the Lord.